One. Calvary Chapel, Concord. Hello. Glad to be with you tonight. For a time of worship, we pulled out some of the older songs. Songs that hurt my fingers when I play them. But that's okay, because we just want you to enter into praise and worship. Glad that we could be in your living room tonight. We do miss you guys. Seeing you, hanging out, and fellowshipping. And Lord knows when the Mr. Governor Gavin can allow us to be back again, but praying that God will just, accomplish what needs to be accomplished and allow us to come back together. Amen. All right. Well, let's just take our hearts and this time for the Lord. Heavenly Father, we just love you. And we thank you, Lord, for this place that we can beam this signal out. And we thank you for the technology to be able to do that. And we pray, God, that you would let it and allow it to go unhindered. That, Father, you would rebuke the enemy, Lord, and let him have no way with any of it. That, Lord, your message, your worship, praise, Lord, unto you, go out unhindered, unobstructed, Lord, clarity, both audioly and visually. Father, to you, we'll just give the honor and the praise and the glory. Hey, Lord, we ask that you'd be with us, especially with those that are hurting tonight, whether it be just mentally, physically, or spiritually. Lord, bring wholeness and healthiness to us as we feast upon your word, feast upon your presence. Lord, where two or three are gathered there. We love you. We praise you. Ask God that you just bless our time tonight. Ask it in Jesus' name. Said.
Amen.
When I go, don't cry for me. In my Father's arms I'll be. The wounds this world left on my soul will all be healed and I'll be whole. Sun and moon will be replaced with the light of Jesus' face. And I will not be ashamed, for my Savior knows my name. It don't matter where you bury me, I'll be home. I'll be free. It don't matter where I lay. All my tears be washed away. Gold and silver blind the eye. Temporary riches lie. So come and eat from heaven's store. Come and drink, thirst no more. It don't matter where you bury me. I'll be home and I'll be free. It don't matter where I lay. All my tears be washed away. Does him. For my life belongs to him who will raise the dead again. It don't matter where you bury me. Well, I'll be home and I'll be free. It don't matter where I lay. Tears be washed away. It don't matter where you bury me. I'll be home and I'll be free. It don't matter where I lay. All my tears be washed away. All my tears be washed away.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of the rise among us, let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Oh, let it rise. Is there any forgiveness for the things I've done? Is there pardon for sinners? I know that I'm one for you. For you. Would you take this heart of foulness? Make it clean again. Would you pour on me your mercy as I confess my sin before you? Before you. Point my feet in the way they should go. Your Holy Spirit in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. I long to have a heart that's pure before you. Is there any forgiveness for the things I've done? Is there pardon for sinners? Well, I know that I'm one before you. Before you. Would you take this heart of foulness? make it clean again. Would you pour on me your mercy as I confess my sin before you? Spirit in me, lead me in the way everlasting. I long to have a heart that's pure. I need to have a heart that's pure. Forgive me, I need your mercy. Oh Lord, forgive me, I need your mercy. I need to have a heart that's pure before you. Before you. Yeah. every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Heart and lead.
I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. I will love you, Lord, my strength. I will love you, Lord, my shield. I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever all my days, I will love you, Lord. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. I will love you, Lord, my strength. I will love you, Lord, my shield. I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever all my days, I will love you. I will. I will love you, Lord, my shield. I will love you, Lord, my rock. Forever all my days, I will love you. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days, hallelujah. Forever all my days, hallelujah. Forever all my days, I will love you, God. In the morning, in the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. When I am alone, oh,
That passes all understanding, doesn't necessarily bring us to understanding, but surpasses it. Father, give to us an understanding. But more than that, Lord, just help us to trust in you. You know, without reservation, without question, to, Lord, embrace you, to cleave to you. And to hold on, Lord, for the craziness of it all. Knowing that, Lord, you are our foundation. You are our rock. You are our strong tower. And Lord, we need daily to come and just be filled and strengthened. Lord, we love you. And we just want to give ourselves to you tonight. And each day, Lord, as we go through this week, Father, let it be just closer and closer to you. And Lord, bless your word as it goes forth tonight. Empower it by the power of your Holy Spirit. May we learn of you, Lord. and draw close to you as we do. We love you and we praise you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. Amen.
Hi, church family. This is another Wednesday. Praise the Lord. And you know, in Joshua, the first chapter, here Joshua is this strong man. He was one of the 12 that came back and said, "Let's go in there and get those giants." But the Lord told him, when he was ready to go into Israel, the land of Canaan, he said, "Be of good courage." He said it a few times to them to emphasize it. During these times, God's saying the same thing. Be of good courage. It's going to end. This will end. We are a church family, and Satan might be laughing at us right now because the church doors are closed. It's harder to witness the people because of the social distancing. But it's going to end. We are a church family. If you need any help, if you need prayer, if you need any help going to the store, or if you have any problems or anything, phone up the church. We're here to help you and anything you need. Now, you know, we also have this Zoom once a week, and you'll be getting an email out when it's going to be. And it's a good way to keep the fellowship going. I can't wait till this is all over with and we all can meet together and laugh together and shake hands and talk and have fellowship again. maybe we'll have a big party or something. Have a big potluck. That's what churches usually do, is have potlucks. And so I can't wait till something like that happens. And, okay, in a minute, Pastor Joe's going to be coming up and giving tonight's message. And I want to thank you for listening in and watching. And just be of good cheer, be of courage, that this will end. The Lord is good. The Lord will take care of you. Okay, and here comes Pastor Joe now.
Thank you, Bob. All right. Tonight we're going to be continuing in our journey through the book, the Gospel of Mark. And we're still in chapter 14 tonight, starting at around verse 32 to verse 42, actually. So if you guys can get settled and get your notepad and your Bible, and settle on in, and we'll see what the Lord has for us here. Again, guys, we're currently in the longest chapter in Mark's gospel. In this chapter, we see Mary anointing him, Judas betraying him, the religious leaders arresting him, and finally, Peter denying him. We've talked about that extravagant work of our act of worship by Mary in giving her gift unto the Lord, and just the lasting impact of it and the cost of it. We talked about the betrayal of Judas and betrayals in general and the forms that really it takes. Samson and Delilah and David, Absalom and Ahithophel. We saw it with Judas and Jesus, and it's brutal and it hurts and it makes you not want to trust another person. But Jesus, you notice, gave Judas the place of honor the very night in which he betrayed him. And when Judas would come just a few hours later with the soldiers who would arrest him, Jesus would say to Judas, "Friend, wherefore art thou come? Why did you come?" And really, to the very end, Jesus gave Judas an opportunity to repent. We talked about communion, the broken bread, the Lord's table, what it is and what it isn't, that it is a symbol to remember. It's healing, it's cleansing, It's intimacy with Jesus. It's priorities. In other words, keeping things first. Or they keep the main thing. But it's also togetherness. It's about what we have in common. It's about belonging to one another. Discerning the Lord's body. Or recognizing. Not understanding that Jesus died for us will not get us there, guys. The church is the body of Christ. And Paul is talking about examining our hearts concerning our relationships with one another. Do I really realize, do we understand that the people that the Lord places in our lives as a church body, guys, they're the ones that make up that body of Christ. And then last time, we talked about Peter's denial in verses 27 through 31. But he begins by saying that Jesus will stumble all. Everyone's going to stumble because of him. And really, in terms of stumbling, he's referring to the offense, that we're going to be offended. But here, as the Lord puts that stumbling block, sometimes that stumbling block isn't as we understand it. That is to cause us to perhaps be tripped up, or to cause us to begin to distrust people that are around us. Jesus offended others, and we talked about the example of John the Baptist and his disciples as they went to ask Jesus, hey, you know, are you the one that is to come, or is there another we should be waiting for? And the response that went back to him, tell him about those that are being set free. Tell him about those that walk, and the lame see, you know, the walking, and the blind are seeing, and the deaf hear. And he said, tell him this. Blessed is he that is not offended with me. And it's so important that we understand that we can be offended. You know, we talked about those people that waited all day long to be healed from early in the morning till late at night. When Jesus said, hey, send them away. We've got, it's time to go. And I can imagine just being upset. Lord, I waited all this time to be healed. And you're just going to leave now? But he says, blessed is that person who's not offended in me. But he talked about that. And he talked about the stumbling of the gray areas. For the Romans, the issue of eating meat that's sacrificed unto idols. It was a gray area. Or an example more used, I think, in our day is the drinking of alcoholic beverages. A gray area. The Bible doesn't expressly prohibit it. It prohibits being drunk. But some people have real trouble at the thought of drinking anything alcoholic, and that's okay. But if you don't have a problem, if you seem to have a freedom with it, you should not do it in such a way as that would stumble the weaker brother that does have a problem with that. And so Jesus said to them, lastly, in verse 27, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. And Peter said to him, hey, even if all these other guys, these bozos, they blow it, I will never do that, Lord. I'll never leave you. But what Peter was doing was elevating himself above all the other disciples. And he finds himself arguing with the Word of God and arguing with what God says about heaven. Not so sure that's a smart place to be in. And Jesus said to him, verse 30, assuredly I say to you that today, even this night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. You know, Peter, you're crowing about how great you are, but soon you'll discover otherwise. And it would break him, guys, as we see. I was looking at a bumper sticker the other day. I had not really saw that one, but it said, lead me not into temptation. And then below it, in parentheses, it said, never mind, I can find the way myself. There was a little boy that always went next door to play in his neighbor's yard, even though his mom had warned him against doing so. And this worried the mom so badly that she asked him, why are you so disobedient? And he replied, and he said that Satan tempted him so bad that he didn't know what to do. The mom then advised him to say, get thee behind me, Satan, whenever he was tempted. She then built a fence around the house. But this only worked for about a week. Then one sunny afternoon, the mom looked over the fence through the window, and There was her son playing in the neighbor's lawn, having cut a hole in the fence. She yelled his name, John, come here. She then said, did I not tell you to say, get thee behind me, Satan, whenever he tempted you? And the boy said, yes, I said, get thee behind me, Satan. And then he went behind me and he pushed me through the hole in the fence. Tonight we're going to look at that subject of temptation. And he begins it with the prayer in Gethsemane. In verse 32, then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. Gethsemane we know as the oil press, located in the olive orchard on the Mount of Olives. And the whole group, it appears, is supposed to stay in one spot while Jesus goes in prayer, our praise. But then verse 32 tells us that he took Peter and James and John with him. And he began to be troubled and deeply distressed. This speaks volumes to me. And I use this as one of the messages that I sent out to you over the past couple of weeks. And really, I don't know if we should take comfort in this, but I suppose it's okay. But it says he began to be troubled and deeply distressed. Facing spiritual and physical suffering more intense than anything any of us could imagine, Jesus went to the garden to pray. And he asked Peter and James and John to go with him. But I find it interesting that he, and I mentioned this last week as we were closing, but he didn't ask them to pray with him. He simply asked them to be with him. And I find it kind of interesting, actually amazing, that during the most intense time of his whole life, that Jesus would want human companionship. There's no shortage of people that will say, Lord, I'll work for you. But I wonder how many would say, Lord, I'm just taking some time to be with you. And you got to understand, at the time, he was facing the cross. He had come to that hour. And later he said to Pilate in John 12:27, for this hour did I come into the world. This is why I came into this world. This is why, for this purpose. And he prayed unto the Father. You guys wait here. Watch. Wait and watch. And then he went forward a little way from them and fell on the ground. Notice he was sore amazed. That is very heavy, troubled, deeply distressed. Even though Jesus had known all along what lay up the road, what was ahead for him. At this point, it seems as if the horror of the cross and the weight of the cross just descends upon him. That word to be troubled, ekthambeo, means to throw into terror or amazement. Deeply distressed, ademoneo, to be troubled. Great distress or anguish. There are three words that are used in the Greek in the New Testament for depression. This one is the strongest. And then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Exceedingly sorrowful, prolepos, surrounded with sorrow. And so Jesus comes to the guys and he ask them to do just two things. Number one, stay put. And number two, keep their eyes open. Watch. We'll see at the end of the passage that Jesus, I think, is also expecting them to pray as well. But here he was, this man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. You know, we might be tempted as we look to think that, you know, what Jesus did for us was a piece of cake for him. The writer of Hebrews tells us how we can endure difficult times when it says in chapter 12, verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Again, you see that phrase, for the joy. And you can think that, well, maybe it was easy for Jesus. But guys, what Jesus faced wasn't anywhere near fun. As he faced the cross, he was struggling to do what he needed to do. He was struggling with it. Here was the Son of God who had always enjoyed sweet, intimate fellowship with the Father. Had that fellowship, had that relationship. He had been tempted in his life, but he never had tasted the shame and the guilt of having committed sin. He knew that he was not going only to face extreme pain as he was scourged and crucified, but he also knew that he was going to experience the darkness and the weight from the guilt and the shame of every one of your sins and every one of my sins and the world's sins that were laid upon him. He was going to experience for the first time being separated and forsaken by God. And this wasn't something that he was looking forward to, obviously. But really, truly, if you think about it, if you have a moment just to contemplate what that really meant. He wasn't just looking at it going like it was another day. You know, it was heavy upon him. He understands sorrow. He understands the heaviness of soul. And he understands depression. Isaiah 53:3 said, he is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. We didn't recognize it. He understands sorrow, his own sorrow, but more than that, he understands our sorrow. For in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, it says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. If you're struggling with a time of sorrow, if you're struggling with a time of despondency and depression, you know, I keep reading certain articles in the International Critical Incident Stress Foundation and the different ways in which they're approaching the stress, how to manage it as a result of the coronavirus or COVID-19. And guys, people are struggling. You know, I see some that are just like, hey, the Lord knows. I was watching another show where an individual who had the virus, and what she was trying to express the heaviness of what she went through. And she's saying, you can't imagine. You know, you just have no idea what it's like to be, first of all, having the coronavirus, but to know and feel yourself at death's door, especially for someone that doesn't know the Lord, especially for someone who does not have that relationship. But Jesus said he understood that sorrow. He understands it when we go through those things. Yet without sin, without missing the mark. So come boldly to the throne of grace that you might obtain mercy, that you might find grace to help in that time of need. Where do we go when we're in that time of need? Guys, you go boldly to the throne of grace. If you're struggling with sorrow, if you're struggling with depression, discouragement, despondency, not only does Jesus understand that, but he can help you as well. What can you do if you're depressed? Pay attention to what Jesus did. Pay attention to what he does. Verse 34, then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. So do what? Stay here and watch. One of the things that we see with our Lord is that he had companions. He wasn't alone. He did not isolate himself. He didn't want to be alone. As we said earlier, he wanted his friends to be near. Sometimes when we're depressed, we can run someplace and hide. Hide from people. And I've talked with people before. They go in their bedroom, turn off the lights, pull the shades, pull the covers over their head, and they just stay there. I said, no, you can't do that. You need companions. You need people. And it seems here that Jesus wanted his disciples nearby. There was a commercial on television at one point about one of the Major League Baseball teams. And in the commercial, as the radio announcer is talking about, you know, the team being behind and, you know, falling behind and, you know, they need, and then really in a need of a rally and something to happen in order to turn things around, the momentum. And it shows people in this commercial all around town in the various jobs that they have, one by one. They take the various hats that they're wearing, they turn the hats inside out, and it was kind of their way of all joining together to make a statement that they're rooting for their team. And right about that time, the announcer says, because we're all in this together. Because we're all in this together. Wouldn't it be cool if we could in some way turn our hats, so to speak, inside out for each other, for one another, when we're struggling? Maybe not visibly or, you know, but our spiritual hat, our cap. It's like Hebrews 10, verse 24 says, think of ways to encourage one another to outburst of love and good deeds. Provoke one another to love. And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage and warn each other, especially now that the day of his coming back again is drawing near. That verse takes on new meaning today. Right now, the fate in many states of whether the church will be able to congregate again is being decided for you and for me. You know, some people are looking 6 months out before they'll allow the church to, that's been mentioned. Don't know how valid it is. Before they'll let us come back together. And yet the Bible says here, let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. He is with companions. Then notice what he says in verse 35. He went a little farther and he fell on the ground. And he prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. If it's possible. The Bible tells us that the cross of Jesus Christ is foolishness to the Greeks, but it's a stumbling block to the Jew. The Jew's concept of the Messiah was of a reigning king, overthrowing the powers of the world and establishing the kingdom of God. And that was a correct concept of the Messiah, but their timing was off. That will be true when Jesus comes again to establish God's kingdom upon the earth. He'll bring down the governments of the world. We all know from studying the book of Daniel when Nebuchadnezzar's dream occurred and Daniel gave the interpretation and then Daniel's vision and how that the stone not cut with hands smites the image of the great world empires and they begin to crumble, feet and all, the empires of men. And the stone grows into a mountain that covers the earth. And so Daniel, in interpreting it, said this, chapter 2, verse 44, "And in the days of those 10 kings shall the Lord of glory come and establish a kingdom that shall never end." The kingdoms of men were going to succeed one another throughout the centuries, but God will establish an internal kingdom, His kingdom upon the earth. And for the kingdom that we long and we pray for, "Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." And so now here we have a picture of Jesus. He's there on the ground praying, "If it's possible, if it's possible." You see, the cross is an offense to people because there are so many that like to say there are many ways to reach God. It's an offense to them because that's what they've settled into. Hey, you don't have to just go one way. There's many ways to reach God. And everybody comes to God in their own way, but it really doesn't matter which way you come to God. It's that we obey those impulses of our spirit and that we come to God in that way. That's what's important. How we come is not as important, you see. But you see, the problem with that is what? The cross doesn't say that. The cross says that there is only one way that you can come to God. And that is why it offends people. You can't just have one way. I've talked to people, they get really upset when you get to that point, really uptight. When you tell them that you don't believe that Buddhists are going to heaven. "Oh, don't say that. Who do you think you are? If Buddhists could go to heaven by doing their prayers and going through their religious routines, then Jesus would not have had to die. If you could go to heaven by being good, Jesus wouldn't have to die. If you could go to heaven by being sincere in your religious beliefs, then Jesus wouldn't have had to die. If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. If man can be, in other words, saved by any other means, if there's any other way." But Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." John 14, verse 6. Guys, Christianity is very narrow, admittedly so. But Jesus said, "Straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leads to eternal life. Few there be that find it." Matthew 7, 14. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many go in thereat. Yeah, it's very narrow, very straight. And the cross bears witness of that. And he went on and he said, verse 36, "Abba, Father." We already know that that's more personal, papa or daddy kind of a word. He said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you." Father, you can do anything. Take this cup away from me. This is the prayer of Jesus, pouring out his heart to the Father. All things are possible to thee. Lord, take this cup from me. But then he quickly adds, "Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." And there, guys, we find Jesus setting for us an example in prayer that the purpose is not to get our will done, but the purpose is to get his will done. There are people today that say, if you pray, "Not my will, but thy be done," that it's a cop-out on your part. They'll say that it's a lack of faith on your part. How can they say that when Jesus himself recognizing that all things are possible with God, and yet, "Not what I will, but your will be done, Lord"? Later on, we read that Jesus prayed the same prayer three different times. There are those that say if you repeat the prayer a second time or a third time, it shows that you didn't have faith in the first time that you prayed. All this weird teaching on faith. You know, how to get your will done. How to make God your little genie to do your bidding. And they would change the Lord's Prayer to, "My kingdom come, my will be done on earth as it is in heaven." But not our Lord. Our Lord is submitting himself now to the will of the Father. Now, why could he do that? Why could Jesus submit to God's will? Because he understands and understood God's nature. God revealed himself to Jesus. It was that intimacy, if you would. But Jesus saw God not as a cosmic killjoy, not as an angry cop. Jesus saw God as a father, as a papa, as an Abba. The greatest prayer of faith we make is when we say, "Lord, here's my perspective, here's my intention, but it is your will that must be done. Because you see things that I don't see. And you know things that I could never know." When you are truly secure in who the Father is, you'll find yourself praying his will to be done, rather than demanding that your own plan would be enacted. Now, interesting little tidbit. In using that word Abba, Daddy, this was not the way that the Jewish people were taught to pray, because they thought that it was inappropriate to call God their daddy. And yet, this is how Jesus prayed. And guess what? It's how he wants us to pray. Galatians 4:6 says, "And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father." And you notice again that Jesus, when he went to pray, that if it were possible, verse 35. Now he acknowledges that indeed all things are possible, right? God is able and strong enough to do anything. So as if possible, take this cup. The verb's an imperative there. He's asking, even perhaps borderline ordering, the Father to remove the cross. His prayer has a couple elements to it. One, all things are possible with God. When we come to prayer, guys, and pray, it's important to remember who we're talking to. There's nothing too difficult for God. Jeremiah prayed in chapter 32, verse 17, "Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee." Or when David faced the giant Goliath, but he knew he wasn't alone. 1 Samuel 17, verse 45. Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied." And when Jehoshaphat faced a fearful coalition of his enemies' armies, he prayed in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 6, "O Lord God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? And do you not rule over all the kingdoms of the nations? And in your hand is there not power and might, so that no one is able to withstand you?" Guys, the size of your problem is only as scary as the size of your God. The smaller your God, the more you're going to worry. But when you realize how big God is, maybe that problem isn't all that big after all. Second thing here, whose will? Man, guys, listen, if we could just learn to pray for the things that God wants, we'd have all our prayers answered. 1 John 5:14. "Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him." When Jesus said, "Take this cup from me," he was asking, but was he asking according to the Father's will? No. Jesus was expressing his own will, and that's okay. That's a part of what the process of prayer is all about. Sorting out my will from God's will. What was God's will? It was God's will that Jesus die on the cross. He was supposed to be a sacrifice to pay for our sins. He paid a debt he didn't owe because we owed a debt we couldn't pay. Heaven isn't filled with people that are good enough to be there. Heaven's filled with sinners who have found forgiveness by trusting in Jesus Christ. One person wrote, "I was shocked, confused, bewildered as I entered heaven's door. Not by the beauty of it all, by the lights or its decor, but it was the folks in heaven that made me sputter and gasp. The thieves, the liars, the sinners, the alcoholics, and the trash. There stood the kid from seventh grade who swiped my lunch money twice. Next to him was my old neighbor who never said anything nice. Herb, who I always thought was rotting away in hell, was sitting and pretty on cloud nine, looking incredibly well. I nudged Jesus, "What's the deal? I would love to hear your take. How all these sinners get up here? God must have made a mistake. And why is everyone so quiet, so somber? Give me a clue." "Hush, child," he said. "They're all in shock. No one thought they'd see you." We need to yield to God's will. When Jesus taught the disciples how to pray, he gave them that example you all know. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9. "In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Guys, peace comes when we yield to his will. Victory comes when we learn to surrender. Paul had been struggling with something, hadn't he? Real difficult in his life. He prayed and he asked God to take the thing away 3 times. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 8. "Concerning this thing, I pled with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I would rather boast in my infirmities,'" Paul said, "that the power of Christ may rest on me." My strength is made perfect in weakness. You see, Paul was brought to the place, or got to the place, where he was able to surrender to God's will. How is God going to answer my prayer? You all know that. He's either going to say yes, if you're asking according to his will. He's going to say no. He's God. He can say no, and that's okay. Or he's going to say wait. Because sometimes you're asking for the right thing, but it's not the right time. What you're asking for may be good, but God doesn't want a good time to be the answer to the prayer. He wants the best for you. Some prayers are kind of like a quick pass, a T-pop to your tight end. Boom, straight on to the guy. It's caught and off he goes to the races. Some prayers are like a long, long bomb to your wide receiver. The quarterback tosses the ball way up in the air and it just flutters. It kind of hangs while everybody runs around. But that one knows where that ball is going to come down. He tosses it way up into the air, the quarterback does. It hangs up there and you watch as the wide receiver runs right underneath the ball coming down and it's caught. Another thought is that sometimes God wants you to persevere in prayer. I think some answers to prayer require a certain amount of prayer. In heaven, the prayers of the saints are represented by bowls of incense. And I wonder if there are different sized bowls. I wonder if some prayers require 10 pounds of incense while others require only a pinch. However you look at it, if God hasn't said no to you, then he wants you to learn to persevere in prayer. Keep praying, guys. Then, check it out, verse 37. "He came," the Lord did, "and he found them sleeping. And he said to Peter," Simon. He didn't say Peter, he said Simon. "Are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour?" Jesus had already changed Peter's name from Simon, or Simon means shifting sand, to Peter, rock.
But here, finding him asleep, Jesus calls him Simon once again. Why does Jesus address Peter? Remember how early in the evening, when Jesus warned the disciples that they were going to deny him, you remember what Peter's response was? Me? I would never do that. In the strongest of terms, he pronounced that and made that pronouncement. I will never do that. Ever would I ever deny Jesus. He said he was even willing to die with Jesus. You have to wonder if this isn't a bit of the gentle rebuke to the one that was so confident that he would never deny the Lord. But he said to them, verse 38, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. For the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. You know, true prayer, guys, listen, is as much protection as it is petition. True prayer is as much protection as it is petition. Things happen to me, I believe, that wouldn't have happened had I prayed. And I think the same is true for you. I also think that things don't happen to us because we do pray. Works both ways. But here Jesus says, watch, guys, and pray. Watch means to give strict attention, to be cautious, to be active. He says, the Spirit indeed is willing. The Spirit is the pneuma. Jesus is talking about Peter's own human spirit here. Jesus knows that Peter's not a slouch. Peter, he knows that Peter wants to do the right thing. He wants to do what is right. But the flesh, which means there in the Greek, man's sin nature. That is his tendency to do opposite of what God wants him to do. Kind of reminds me of a story. From time to time, an angel had been spotted at an old house outside of town. Over the years, many rumors had circulated about the whys and the whatnots of this particular phenomena. Well, finally, a photographer decided he would go and take pictures of the house and the angel that lived there. And upon arriving, the angel actually greeted him at the door. And upon welcoming him into the house, he told the man that he would be more than pleased to pose for some pictures. The photographer, extremely grateful for the opportunity, readied his camera and he began to take many pictures. However, his flash did not seem to be operating so well. He finished the session, though, and upon thanking the angel, returned home to develop the pictures. But upon doing so, he found the pictures were all grossly under are overexposed, and he fell to his hands and knees, weeping, saying, the spirit was willing, but the flesh was weak. Yes, I said that. Speaking again of the weakness of our flesh, Paul wrote, Romans chapter 7, verse 15, for what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it's good. But now it's no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me. But how to perform what is good, I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. The very thing I want to do, I don't do. The very thing I don't want to do, I end up doing. Oh, wretched man that I am. How many of us are familiar with these verses? And yet we continue to have struggles with our flesh. We continue to sin. It's a hard lesson to learn. Even though we fail so often, we have this idea that we can still pull off obeying Jesus on our own strength. The answer to our flesh is to learn to completely depend on Jesus and not on our flesh. John 15:5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him
bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. And so again, he went away and prayed, and he spoke the same words. Again, Jesus prays what he prayed back in verse 36. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. He caught him sleeping and falling asleep again, and they didn't know what to say. And then verse 41, he came a third time, and he said, "Are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners." Try to put yourself in their shoes, in their position. Put yourself in the Lord's position and see how he would minister. Now, at this point, there's a possibility of a gap of time between verses 41 and 42. Not really sure of the duration, but it appears as if there's a time gap. And Jesus tells his disciples to go ahead and give in to the sleep. Some teach that it shows a lack of faith to pray for something more than once, like I said. Didn't seem like Jesus followed this rule, though. Go ahead and sleep, guys. Take your rest. It's enough. The hour has come. And it could be even that Jesus just sat there for a half hour or even an hour just watching them as they slept. But more importantly, I believe he was praying for them. You could not watch with me, but now I will watch you. I believe that this was the time when he perhaps was interceding for them, knowing what they're going to go through, knowing the heartache and the pain and the questions that they're going to have. This is going to be a rough day on them all, because all of their dreams are going to be shattered when they watch him die on the cross. He hasn't been able to get through to them exactly what death, his death, is going to mean. In fact, they always think, you know, when he starts talking about his death, that he's talking in riddles. And knowing how that their hopes are going to be dashed, I believe that he just spent some time sitting there watching them, praying over them, like you would your child as he goes to bed and is laying there in his bed, and you sneak back in and you just kneel down or you sit on the floor and you just watch them and pray for them. But then all of a sudden, there's a racket. As Judas is leading in the soldiers of the high priest and the officers. And so Jesus says there in verse 42, "Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." Jesus, very important for us to understand something that he did here. Here comes Judas with all these soldiers. And he says, "Let us be going. Rise." And I really believe that Jesus could rise up because he had already knelt down. He could stand up because he had already bowed down. Jesus found strength for this moment because of the time he had spent in prayer. You will find strength for the moment because you spend time in prayer. But at this point, the time to be prepared with prayer is over, for the moment of trouble has come. And Jesus wakes up the disciples because it's time for him to be betrayed and arrested. What did he do when he was overwhelmed? What did he do when he was surprised with despondency, depression, and discouragement? What did he do? He prayed. What did Jesus encourage his disciples to do in order to prepare themselves for what laid ahead? He told them, verse 38, "Watch and pray." Jesus was trying to teach his disciples that one of the best things that they could do in regards to temptation was to be watching and praying. They needed to have their eyes open, that's watching, but they also needed to be praying. The biggest work for Jesus was still ahead on the cross. But before the great work, there was the battle in prayer. The real battles are won first in the prayer closet before you get to the battlefield. Pastor Chuck said you can do more than pray after you've prayed, but you really can't do any more for God than pray until you've prayed. You can't really do any work or service for God apart from prayer. I was reading about King Rehoboam, the son of King Solomon. When Rehoboam became king, he was faced with a difficult decision. In a sense, it was a temptation or a trial for him. For the people wanted Rehoboam to lighten up on the workload that his father had forced on the people. And Rehoboam didn't know what to do, so he decided to ask for advice. He asked advice of the old men who had served his father, and they told him, lighten up. And then he asked advice from the guys that were his own age, and they told him to get tougher. In the end, he went with the advice from his younger friends, and the kingdom of Israel split at that time into two kingdoms. For a long time, I look at this and I think, you know, this is a lesson about learning to respect the advice of your elders. But then all of a sudden it hit me. There's one person who Rehoboam didn't ask for advice. Who was that? He didn't ask God. When Rehoboam's grandfather David needed advice, David asked God. David went to God. Jesus taught us to pray in Matthew 6:13. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And I have to wonder how many temptations we could simply avoid if we prayed more. Some things were not going to be able to be avoided, but I wonder how many of those tests we could have passed easier if we had learned to pray more. Amen. Father, we just come to you, Lord, and we thank you for this time in your word, Lord. We thank you for the example of Peter and, Lord, just of you. As Father, you put a premium on prayer. Father, you demonstrated how essential, how important it is. That, Father, we go to you. And, Lord, not expect you to act like a genie, but, Lord, to direct us and guide us and lead us. Lord, to fill us with your Holy Spirit. Because, Father, we don't know which way to go often. And we need to hear from you. We need to be directed by you and shown the way. So Father, just pray that you'd speak to us through this word that you've given to us tonight, Lord. As we look at the example, Father, that we wouldn't fall for those temptations. Lord, we would be attentive, Lord, to your yes, to your no, and to your wait. And not grow impatient, not throw a tantrum. But Lord, simply say, not my will be done, but yours. Because Lord, we really want and should want and desire your will and your purpose for our life. So Father, help us and draw us closer to you each and every day. We might know you. Father, we might hear your voice and respond, Lord, to your leading. We love you and we praise you. Now go with us, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, guys, God bless you. Love you. Thanks for stopping in tonight. We'll be praying for you and sending some things out to you again. We'd like to get together for Zoom. I don't know exactly when the time will be, but we'll let you know about it, all right? You got anything, Britt?